Hello and welcome everyone. Welcome to the sixth episode of Azure Community Live. Today we have a bit different setup compared to normally where we dial in people through Skype. Today we have a guest from the Netherlands. I am in the Netherlands as well, so we could do this in this office here. So we're a bit more close by, it's easier to chat than just doing this through Skype. So if you ever want to speak at Azure Community Live, you can do that through Skype, or if you're in the Netherlands, you're welcome to visit the Experience office here where I record these sessions, and then we'll provide you with dinner and then you can host your session here. It's up to you. This week we have a really cool guest, Mark Duyker, who will tell us everything about Azure Durable Functions. So Mark, can you quickly introduce yourself?
Yeah, my name is Mark Duyker. I'm a consultant for Experit, and I really like to work with event-driven architectures in Azure. And I really enjoy working with Azure Functions and Durable Functions. So I really like to talk about it a lot. So thanks for offering me this opportunity.
Yeah, no problem. So let's dive into the content, and then Mark can start his session.
All right, let's get started. So let's talk about complex workflows and Azure Functions. I already introduced myself. Maybe I need to explain my new profile picture. I'm really into retro games and also pixel art lately. And apparently I'm not the only one. I see it across several people in IT. It's really funny. I even made also a small retro game. I'll share a link later. So if you want to play an Azure Functions related game, you can actually do that now.
So one small addition to before we start with the actual content. So if you have any questions during the talk, please ask them on the chat. I will redirect them to Mark so he can answer the questions. So if there are any comments or things you would like to share, please do that on the chat. Continue.
All right. Okay, so I'm going to talk about these points. Firstly, let's really discuss what a workflow actually is. And then I'm going to show you what Durable Functions is. We're going to talk about orchestrations and different application patterns Durable Functions allows you to write. And finally, I'm going to talk about how you can use multiple orchestrations within one function app, but also across several function apps. So let's start with workflows. So if you look at the Wikipedia definition of what a workflow is, it says it consists of an orchestrated and repeatable pattern of activity. And this, the wording actually matches very nicely of the names that Durable Functions is using. Yeah, so there's something that orchestrates different activities and that always runs through a repeatable pattern. So I think this is a very easy to understand the definition. So for example, let's take this workflow. I've built this a while ago for one of my own projects. It starts based on the timer, so it runs in this case every hour. First, we will get some data from a table, but then it needs to actually do two things. It needs to get something from the cloud, and it again retrieve something from a table. Then at this point, it needs to combine the data from these two things, and based on the combination, it needs then to store something. And finally, it needs to actually push the result to the web again. And in case something goes wrong, I want to put some information on a message queue to look at it later. So yeah, I consider this to be a typical workflow application, which you would have normally also as well in your architectures, regardless if it's serverless or not. When we look at workflow applications or even workflow management applications, these have existed for already quite some time already. Maybe some of you know BizTalk server. That's really a middleware solution, quite a big solution, where you can design your workflows in a graphical UI and integrate with lots of other stuff. It's I think the most recent release actually from this year, so it's still a recent product. But I looked up the initial release, and that was in December 2000. So it's a product which is nearly 20 years old. But apparently still widely used, because otherwise Microsoft wouldn't keep developing this product. So apparently it's quite important for companies to have some kind of solution to handle their workflows. When we look at the other spectrum, more lightweight, and also we're focused on Azure, we have, for instance, Azure Logic Apps, which again uses a graphical interface to connect your workflow and to really integrate with hundreds of other services. And another one is Power Automate, it used to be called Flow, more an end-user, business-user product. So I'm not going to talk about either of these solutions, because right now we are going to look at another alternative, more focused on code, and that is Dribbble Functions. So what is exactly Dribbble Functions? It's an extension on top of Azure Functions, and it allows you to write your workflow in code. So that is, you can write it in C# or in JavaScript. So it's really part of your code base. So there's no graphical designer for your workflow. So in addition to that, you can actually also unit test it quite well. So that's the benefit of having it in code. And for developers, they understand code the best. So I think that's a good solution. In addition, it stores the state of that workflow in a storage account. And that actually brings some nice benefits because you can save the state and also restore the state. It allows the orchestration to last very long. So you are not limited to the maximum execution time of just one Azure function. And your workflow can actually be a long-running process encompassing many hours or days even. So when you start working with Dribbble Functions, you'll notice that there are different function roles. So the first one is called the orchestration client function. In the new API, this is also referred to as the Dribbble client function. And the responsibility of this client function is to create a new instance of an orchestrator function. And this orchestrator function then contains all kinds of sequences and all kinds of patterns to call out to different activities. And in the activity, you will normally make a call to a database or you post something to a web service. It's usually something you do out of process then. So if we map those roles on this existing workflow, then our timer triggered function will be our Dribbble client, because that actually initiates the creation of an orchestrator. And yeah, what is then the actual orchestration? In this case, it's all of the orange lines, because that actually connects all of the activities, and the activities in this case are all the numbered squares. So let's look at some code samples of all these different functions. So here's an example of an orchestration client function. In this case, it's a regular HTTP triggered function, and when I do a post to this route, which actually can contain the orchestrator name, I can start an orchestrator. And Azure Functions notes that this is a client function because we are using the Dribbble client attribute here. So when we use the orchestration client like this, we first read some input from the HTTP request, and then we can use the start new async method to start a new instance of an orchestrator. And we do that by providing the name of the orchestrator, which in this case we got from the URL, and we provide the input. And what's important to realize is that you're actually not making a direct call to an orchestrator function. You're actually scheduling a task, and that task will then actually make sure that an orchestrator will be instantiated and will be run. So what you get back is not directly the result of an orchestrator. What you get back is the result of a task, and in this case is an instance ID of that orchestrator. In this case, it's an HTTP triggered function, so we can give back a response, and Dribbble Functions provides a built-in method to actually return some status information about an orchestrator that you just created. So if you call this method and provide the request and also the instance ID of the orchestrator you just created, it will give you back a 200 result with some information, and that looks like this. So there are a lot of information in here. The most important thing is the ID, because this is the orchestrator, the instance ID of the orchestrator. And you probably want to use this indeed for querying the status. If your orchestrator actually has returned a result, then you can actually query for that result by using the URL in the location header. Okay, so let's look at the next role. That's the orchestrator function. So this is a very basic example of an orchestrator function, and I'll go into a bit more depth on the different patterns you can use in these functions. But if you use the orchestration trigger attribute, then the runtime knows you're working with this orchestrator function role. And so you have the Dribbble orchestrator context to your disposal, and that has some methods, for instance, to retrieve some inputs from the context. In this case, we're just passing it in a type of string, so we retrieve a string from the context, and that can then be used in different calls to activities. So here's the first call to an activity function. Call activity async, but I will explain in a slide a bit later what all the types are here. So here's the first call, and here is then a call to a second activity. And again, here you're not making a direct call to a different function. You're actually creating a task which is scheduled actually to run your activity function. So here's a code example for an activity function. In this case, it's a very minimal function, and because we use the activity trigger attribute, and the runtime knows we are dealing with an activity function. And in this case, it just calls external servers, which we are passing in through a constructor, and just returns the result from that from the service. So I mentioned a couple of times that the methods you write, it doesn't actually start or call different functions directly. Tasks are being used and things are scheduled. So with this slide, I want to explain a bit how Dribbble functions works under the hood, because I think if you understand it into a bit more depth, I think you can write better quality in the orchestrators. So let's start with the Dribbble client to start a new orchestrator instance. So whenever you use the method start new async, under the hood, a method will be placed on the queue, and also the actual start of the orchestrator will be checkpointed into table storage. As soon as the orchestrator has been created, it will return the instance ID to the client, and what is then stored in table storage is actually the instance ID of the orchestrator and also any input that is used to start your orchestrator. So then the orchestrator instance starts and will continue executing until it finds the first call to an activity. Again, that activity is not called directly, but again, a message is placed on the queue. It is checkpointed that function one is now scheduled. Then the function is actually executing, and at the same time, the orchestrator will actually stop executing. So at any moment, you only have an activity function that is running or an orchestrator function that's running. So once the activity function is done, it will put a message on the queue again. It will mark in the table storage that it is completed. So we'll also see the output of it in table storage. And the orchestrator function will be instantiated again. And it will replay. So, and it will first replay, and it will check if it's already completed function A1, and it will check in storage that it already has completed, so it can use the result from the storage account. So then it will check from have I already run function 2? No, I have not. So that task will be scheduled again. And then the same thing happens. Function activity 2 will actually start. It will do the work. The orchestrator will be terminated, or will actually stop then. And once the result is ready, message is placed on the queue again, which will replay the orchestrator again. So again, it will first check if have I already completed A1. Yes. Have I completed A2? Yes. Well, then I will actually go to schedule the last activity in this case. And the same thing will happen. That will start. The orchestrator will stop again. And once it has been completed, the orchestrator will finally replay again, and then it will go over them one time more, because then it needs to check have I completed everything, and then there's no other activities to be done. And at that time, the orchestrator is actually done with all the work. So as you can see, there's a lot of things actually going on. So lots of messages being scheduled. Lots of state is checkpointed into this storage table. So it's very important to know that things are going on like this. And it's also very important to realize that this orchestrator code is replaying a lot of times. Especially when you're debugging these for the first time, you will see that if you place a breakpoint in your orchestrator code, that will be hit a lot of times because this orchestrator is being replayed a lot of times. So, and that also places some limitations on the code you write in your orchestrator. Yeah, so that code needs to be idempotent. It needs to be that needs to be the same for every execution, all the replays. It needs to have the same result. So for instance, it wouldn't be wise to create a new GUID in your orchestrator or do something with daytime in your orchestrator and pass that as an argument to your activity function. So there are actually some methods inside the context of your orchestrator to actually create valid GUIDs and to use the current daytime to replace the other functionalities. So those are important.
Also, when you do logging, right? When I did this, yes. This the first time, the most logical place to actually do this, do some logging, is in the orchestrator function.
Yeah.
And then when you start looking through your logs, you're like, what's happening here?
Yeah.
All my logs are, like, in this case, executed three times. So that really makes sure that you do those things at the right places.
Exactly. Yeah. And again, you should really investigate the context object a bit, because there's also a method here which actually checks if the context is replaying. So you can place some additional logic inside this if statement. If I'm replaying, do this. If I'm not replaying, and do something else. But indeed, you need to be aware of it that by default your orchestrator is replaying all the time. Okay, it sounds complicated, and it is a bit, but as long as you know what's going on, then you shouldn't have too many problems actually creating these orchestrators. So here's a screenshot to demonstrate what kind of information is stored in table storage. So you can see all kinds of event types, like orchestrator started, execution started, task completed. And you see indeed the names of the orchestrators and activities are being logged. And also had the status of your orchestration. So there's a lot of information in there. I used the Table Storage Explorer, Storage Explorer, to see this view. But in fact, you never need to go in here manually and to check the head states of an orchestrator, because Drupal Functions already provides an API for you. So you can actually retrieve the status by instance ID, or you can retrieve the status based on a query on runtime status or based on the daytime range. So it really provides a useful API. So you don't need to create your own APIs or create your own queries on this. Okay, so let's have a look at some example orchestrations and application patterns that Drupal Functions allows you to do. So let's start with function chaining, which is the most basic one. So the concept of function chaining is that you go from function 1, from function 2, from function 3. But this is more like a concept idea, because in reality, the orchestrator takes care of the function chaining. So function 1 is not aware that there is a function 2, and function 2 is not aware that there is a function 3. So in reality, we have an orchestrator, and from the orchestrator, we will schedule function 1. And then you will wait until it's completed. And once we have the results from function 1, it will actually schedule function 2, and we will await it. And then we will schedule function 3. So only the orchestrator knows about all the activities, and the activities don't know about each other. So here's an example that shows the function chaining. It's a bit similar as I showed earlier. So here we are scheduling our first activity. Use the call activity async method. We already specify the result type there, so it's the function 1 result is the result type of this activity. And then we call the activity by providing the name of the activity. So in this case, I'm using name of, and then I'm providing the class name of the activity, because usually I write just one function in a class, so I can use the name of and then the name of that class to identify which activity I'm calling. And the second argument is then the input argument for the activity. So this is the way to schedule a new call to an activity. And in this case, we use the await. So we do await context call activity async. So we're actually waiting until this first activity is completed before we do anything else. So the orchestrator will continue until it will complete, but it won't continue. So it will stop here. And once the result of this activity is done, then it will replay and then it will continue. So in this case, once the first activity is completed, you'll actually check if there are any details in that result, because usually you would also have some business logic inside your orchestrator, because depending on the business logic, you might want to call out to different activities. So in this case, we're only going to call activity 2 if the first result has some details. And then again, we do the same method call activity async, but now with a different result type and a different name. And finally, your orchestrator can return a result, but that's totally up to you. An orchestrator can also be can just return a task, so it doesn't necessarily need to return a result. It's quite common that you have a final activity somewhere that pushes something state to a storage account or on a queue, which can then trigger something else. But we'll look into that later. So the previous example, let's say, was a bit naive, let's say that activity function 1 always works, it's up 100% of the time. I'm pretty sure it won't be, but let's say activity function 2 is a bit flaky, so it's prone for errors or network errors, so actually it would be nice if you can do some retries on it. Well, luckily, the framework has a built-in method for that. So that's called call activity with retry async. And what it allows you, to use an additional argument of type retry options. And in that retry options, you can specify the time span, how long you want to wait before each retry. You can specify the number of retries here. And you can even specify a backup coefficient, which then allows you, it will actually, in this case, double the time between the retries. So you're not retrying too often, because you might actually, that would be even more hurtful for performance, for instance. So this is a very easy way that Drupal functions provide out of the box to make your orchestrator more resilient. So I would always advise to always use retry options, specifically if you don't have any, if you make out of process calls in your activity, you always do some network travel and things can always go wrong there. Let's have a look at the next application pattern. It's called fan out, fan in. And that is very useful if you want to do a lot of stuff in parallel, because that's the fan out part. But the nice thing of the fan-in part is that you can actually wait until all of your results that run in parallel are completed. So you can do some aggregation over the end result, over all of the outcomes. So for instance, when you have an orchestrator and the input is an array of elements, the first thing that we might want to do is for each item in the array, we want to call a function. So when n is 100, we might want to call this function 100 times. But then we actually want to wait before we continue for our next call, because we want to do some aggregation over all of these 100 results. And so before we go to function 52, we first want to wait that all of these 100 executions are completed. And that is very nicely done in Drupal functions. So in this case, we are again in an orchestrator. In this case, our input is an enumerable of string. So the first thing that we do is actually we define a list of tasks of the output type of the first activity that we're going to call. Then we are iterating over our input, so we're iterating over our names. And then we are creating tasks for the activity we're going to call. So as you can see, we don't use the await keyword here. We're simply just creating the task and putting in the task in our task list. So the activity function one here is not yet executed. Then we do an await task when all, and then provide the task list as an argument there. So, and at this point, when the orchestrator hits this point, it will actually schedule all the tasks, and the orchestrator will wait until all of the results of all the functions are complete and are then in this function one result variable. And once that is completed, the second activity will be called. So this is really a powerful way to execute a lot of activities in parallel and wait for them and do something with the result. Another application pattern is called human interaction. It's also known as external events in the API. So it's best explained with the use case, for instance, for approval. It's also quite common in workflow workflow situations. So let's say this box here is our request that needs to be approved. So here we have a decision point, and someone needs to make a decision. If it's approved, then it goes this way, or it's not approved, then it goes the other way. So let's say in this case there are three people which actually need to approve this request. So how does this look like in Dribbble functions? Well, here we go. There is a wait for external event method, and we expect that the result of the of that method to be of type Boolean, and the identifier of this event is a string. In this case, we are waiting for event approval, event 1, 2, and 3. So again, note that we are not doing an await here, so the approval 1, 2, 3 are actually tasks again, and they're not yet executed. The execution is then at this point. So here we're doing an await task when all, and here we are waiting actually until we have received an external event named like this, and and returns a type bool. So when this orchestrator is being ran, it will run up to here, and then it will wait. Once all these events have come in, then it will continue, and then we can decide if they all are approved. Okay, we do the happy flow, and if not all of them are approved, we'll do the unhappy flow. So, well, this looks quite straightforward, and this will work as long as all approvers will actually supply or actually raise the event. So what happens now if one of the approvers won't send an event? So that means that this orchestrator will be in a running state forever. So that's, of course, not a very desirable solution. So again, we need some bit more resilience in this. And that can be done quite easily. So we can change the signature of this method, and we can actually specify a timeout. So in this case, we've specified a timeout for 48 hours. And we can pass the timeout into the method, and we can also provide a default option. So what will happen in this case, that the orchestrator will wait for 48 hours, and if the event comes in, then fine, the result will be used. But if the event is not raised within 48 hours, or not received within 48 hours, then the default value false will be used. And so this is a very nice fallback solution, which you would definitely need, because otherwise your orchestrator instance will be running forever if it never receives an event. So receiving events is, of course, just one side. The events need to come from somewhere. And sending events can be done in two ways. So one way is using it in a client function, like this. So again, this is just an HTTP trigger function, which can be used by doing a post to the send event / instance ID, because it's important to realize when you raise an event, you always need to raise an event to a really specific instance of an orchestrator. We use the Dribbble client attribute because we can only raise events from an orchestrator client. In this case, we also read the actual approval object from the request body. And then we can use the raise event async method on the client to actually raise the event. And there we provide the instance ID, which is necessary. We supply the event name. In this case, it comes from the approval type. And also the isApproved Boolean is also in our approval type. So this is a way to raise events from a client function. But actually, you don't necessarily need to write this client function because the HTTP API of Drupal Functions already provides an API for this. So then the route will be different. I'll supply a link later what the route actually is. But if you want to trigger a raise an event using HTTP, then I would say just use the built-in way. So you don't actually need to write this code. So like I mentioned, you do need to specify the instance ID when you do want to raise an event. And let's say normally you would probably might want to, for instance, when it's an approval, one of your activities maybe send a notification through email or through Slack containing a link which contains that instance ID. So that the person who approves can just click a link to approve or disapprove. But in case that it doesn't happen, you need to retrieve the instance ID from somewhere. Well, like you saw before in one of the slides from the Storage Explorer, all of the information is available in storage, and you can actually query the storage. So you can actually make a query like this, where you specify a certain time range from, and this is the time range from within where you expect the orchestrator to be created. And you can also specify a runtime status. So in case we just want to query for active orchestrations which are still waiting, we can specify the runtime status as running. So if you run this query, then you actually return all of the instances of orchestrators which are still in a running state and still are still waiting for input. So this would be one way to actually retrieve the information if you still have orchestrators which are not yet completed. Okay, so far we've talked about orchestrators and application patterns, but just a single orchestration. But this talk was also about a bit more complex workflows and orchestrations. So it's also quite common that you have multiple orchestrations. So let's talk about that. So again, we have more options. We have actually two flavors. You can have multiple orchestrations within one function app or multiple orchestrations across different function apps. And just to remind you of how Azure Functions are grouped, Azure Functions are grouped in a function app. So a function app will contain one to many functions. So if you create an orchestrator, you would already have an orchestration client and the orchestrator itself and its activity functions all within one function app. And so it's quite common to see you need a function app with a lot of functions in there, especially if you're doing Drupal functions. Okay, so let's zoom in on how we can actually use multiple orchestrators in one function app.
Mark, do you also have a comparison on when would you use one function app and when would you use multiple function apps, or are you coming back to that?
I'll come back to that. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. That'll be the last one, two slides. Okay. Definitely. Yeah. Good question. Okay, so when you're in a situation of starting multiple orchestrations from one client, you can do that quite easily with the existing methods there are. So let's say you're creating one orchestrator instance which calls three activities from the client. And within that same client code, you can sequentially start another orchestration, which might reuse some activities or calls different ones. It doesn't really matter. But what's important to know is these orchestrators are completely independent. This one will be scheduled and started, and this one will be scheduled and started right after another. So that means you can't actually use any results from this orchestrator in the other orchestrator. Yeah, so that's a limitation if you want to do it like this. So how does it look like in code? So we have a HTTP triggered function, Drupal client, and here we are actually starting the first orchestrator, orchestrator A. So that's being scheduled there, and we return an instance ID of that orchestrator. And straight after, we are starting another one, orchestrator B, and also get the instance ID. So that's fine. This will definitely work. But you better see that the Jupyter Functions framework doesn't really take into account that you start multiple orchestrators and maybe want to return some status information about both orchestrations. Because in this case, it's an HTTP trigger, and then there's this built-in method create stack chase response, but that accepts only one instance ID of an orchestration you started. So if you want to do it like this and you still want to return something to the client about the status of multiple orchestrators, then you have to create your own way of returning that information. So this can be done, but is not ideal. Another way, which is definitely better, would be to use sub-orchestrators. So what is that? Well, let's say you just have a regular orchestrator which is calling one or more activities. In that same orchestrator, you can make calls to sub-orchestrators. And sub-orchestrators are just actually normal orchestrators by themselves again. And the nice thing about this is you can actually make sure that you await the result of this orchestrator and use that result as an input for another orchestrator. So it's definitely more flexible than the previous method. So here's a code sample of how to use sub-orchestrators. So in this case, we are already in an orchestrator, as you can see here. We first have a regular activity call, which we try, but then there is a call to a sub-orchestrator. So there's the call sub-orchestrator, which we try async. So this is then the return type of the orchestrator, and then this is the name of the orchestrator we're calling. And since we are awaiting this, we can use the result of the first orchestrator as an input in our second orchestrator. So that's definitely a benefit of this approach. Okay, so those are still really quite some straightforward situations, but what if you have, let's say, multiple orchestrators across function apps? So I'm going to talk about three solutions, one HTTP, one with queues, and one with Event Grid. So the one with HTTP is definitely the easiest one, but also not the most elegant. What you can do from an orchestrator function is you can use the call HTTP async method, and you provide an HTTP method you want to use. You can pass in the URI, and you pass in the input that you want to give. So this is relatively new feature since Jupyter Functions version 2, because before that you need to put this in an activity, but now you can actually call out to make an HTTP call from within the orchestrator. So if this so the way you can use this or maybe misuse this is if your if the URI that you're passing is actually a Jupyter client which actually starts another orchestrator, then you can somehow need like this start your orchestration from this existing orchestrator. And then note again that you can only start it. You don't have any idea about the result of this orchestration that you're starting, because you're just making an HTTP call, and this will just return the instance of the orchestrator you started, and that's it. But it's definitely the most lightweight way of starting another orchestration which lives in the completely different function app. So here's the function app that you're then calling to. So that's an HTTP triggered function, then a client function, a Jupyter client, as you can see here. This will definitely work and will get you quite a long way, as long as you don't need any information from it. A way which I really actually prefer and I quite often use is using queues between the function apps. So you can imagine that your orchestration trigger does some work, makes some calls to different activities, but then the final activity in your orchestrator actually just puts the result on a queue, and that activity will then look like this. So we just specify the queue name and the connection string of that of the storage account, and it will just has a certain input, and it will just return the input to the queue. So it's a very simple, minimal function. It doesn't do anything else, just puts it on the queue. And then you can have another client function, which actually will be triggered based on the message on the queue. So here you need still a nice decoupling, because in the previous example with the HTTP, you actually, the link to where you're calling to needs to be present in the orchestrator that you're calling from. So you have some kind of hard coding from going from A to B. But in this case, your first orchestrator doesn't need to know anything about the other orchestrator. You just put the message on the queue again. So we just use the queue output binding in an activity, and we have a queue trigger, which is then the durable client. So this can start a new orchestrator again. So I really prefer this method, and I'm still used quite often like this. The final method, final approach I want to discuss is using Event Grid. And I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with Event Grid, but I think it's some kind of best kept secret of Azure sometimes, because I don't hear a lot about it. And unfortunately, not all Azure services are supporting it yet fully. But it is a very nice way of doing the publishing and subscribing of events, of a lot of things that goes on in Azure. So it's actually a service within Azure based on the pub/sub model. So there are event sources within Azure, and those event sources are many different Azure services, and that it can be subscriptions or storage accounts and lots of other things. But in this case, our event source is Drupal Functions, because Drupal Functions supports Event Grid as well. Event sources have topics, usually they have more topics, and the topic with Drupal Functions is actually the status of the orchestration. So if it is running, if it is completed, failed, things like that. So what we can do from our first orchestration is make sure that whenever a orchestration is completed, that will be published to a topic. And then something else, a subscriber, can actually listen to that topic. So on the subscriber side, you have topic subscriptions. And the topic subscription needs to specify, to what am I actually listening? So it needs a referral to the topic. But it also has a referral to an event handler, because an event is published here, but it needs to be sent somewhere else. So the topic is, let's say, the glue between the topic itself and something that handles the event. So when this is a durable function with the status of an orchestrator as the topic, when we subscribe it, when we make a subscription from another Azure function, we can actually start a new we can actually trigger a new function based on the result of the orchestrator. So again, this is very, I think a very elegant way of triggering a whole new function based on the status of an orchestrator. And this is not limited of completed orchestrations, because you can might also want to have a subscription on failed orchestrators and start a new function based on that. So this really allows you a lot of flexibility. So here are some sample scripts, because it is a bit more involved than just passing in status via queues, because you actually need to create a topic, and you need to create a topic subscription, so there are some steps involved to create all this. You can of course do it in the portal, but I still have quite a preference for the Azure CLI. So what I'm showing here is the steps you need to do using the Azure CLI in order to create the topic and the topic subscriptions. So on line 5 is the code of actually creating the topic. But then once you've created the topic, you need to extract some information from it. So you need actually to extract the name and also the key from it, because you need to provide that information in your configuration files of your Azure or your function app that contains the orchestrator. So here's an example of the host JSON of your function app, which runs Jubal functions. So there's a whole section about notifications, and then a whole section about event grid. So you actually need to put the topic name in this topic endpoint parameter, so it knows what the endpoint is of your topic. As you can see, there's a lot of more things you can define, like it also enables retries, so you can specify the retry count and retry interval. And you can even be more specific in what kind of events you are publishing. So in this case, we're only publishing started events, pending events, failed events, and terminated events. So you can be very granular of what type of things you are actually publishing. The other thing you need to capture, you need to put the topic key in your application setting. So line 7 of the script shows you how to extract the topic key. And then you need to create an entry in your app settings. Right? So if you're running locally, it's your local settings JSON, but otherwise it's your app setting in your function app. And you need to put in the topic key there. So what was quite tricky here was you need to make sure that your key name here, so event grid key, that this key is the same as actually the value of the key setting name here. So you need to make sure that these values here are the same between your host JSON and your app settings. So this talks about actually the topic part, so that's the publisher part, but then there's the subscriber part, because now we are actually, when we push this to Azure, we are publishing events to the topic, but nothing is listening to it yet. So this is only half the story. The other part is actually the subscriber part. So we need to actually create an Azure function which will be triggered by an event grid event. So we actually need to write your function and use a NuGet package to enable you to allow this attribute, the event grid trigger. So that's one part. Then you need to create the topic subscription. So again, I'm using the Azure CLI for this. So we need to supply a name. We also need to supply the ID of the topic. So in this case, it's quite a big link of subscriptions and resource groups. And finally, actually the topic we made. And it also needs an endpoint. And there we need to define the event grid key. And the event grid key can then be obtained by doing a GET of your published app. By going to this link, which again requires your master key of your function app. So yeah, as you can see, it's a bit involved to actually realize this. It's definitely not as easy as making an HTTP call or using message queues. But yeah, I think this really is powerful, and yeah, hopefully it will get a bit easier to do all these steps, because it feels a bit too involved for me. It's definitely easier through the portal, but yeah, I would definitely always advise to do as much stuff in code and not do too many things in the portal.
Do you have certain scenarios where you would prefer this over queues?
So far I've mostly used queues, because that was still good enough. So usually, yeah. I want to have a result from an orchestrator, and I just want to use it in another orchestrator, and that's still fine. But like I mentioned, maybe if you want to have more control about edge cases, so maybe if you want to trigger something based on a failed orchestrator or something else, then I would say then it's probably better to use Neat Event Grid.
It feels more like intervening with the actual Azure function, so the actual events from the function, right? From a queue, you will probably have some sort of business event that you would publish and then you will hook onto, right?
You can definitely use it also maybe for in more maintenance or operation scenarios, indeed. Mm-hmm. So maybe you see something has failed, an orchestrator has failed, so maybe you want to remove its data or do something else based on that, or some other alerting. But there are also also a lot of other things about how to detect that. So there's a lot of built-in stuff in application insights and then monitoring. So I don't necessarily want to replace that. So I still think this is also valuable in more of the business workflow or business process. But yeah, it can definitely have more use than just only business store, only operations. But yeah, like I said, I didn't had a use case yet where I really needed event create. Use are usually enough.
Okay.
All right, so we're near the end. So I've showed you quite a lot of different ways how to use orchestrations for single orchestrations and then also multiple orchestrations. But yeah, as always within creating software, please adhere to the KISS principle. Keep it simple and small. There are other variations of this, but it definitely applies to durable functions as well. For certainly applies to the orchestrators, because it's very easy now to create your workflows in code, and maybe you will want to create an orchestrator which calls out to 30 activities, but yeah, then your orchestrator is really huge and it's probably not so readable anymore. It's probably then also difficult to unit test, and because everything, all the contexts are passed in by interfaces, so your orchestrator is actually very easily unit testable. Mm-hmm. But if you make it really big, then you make it difficult for yourself again. So I would definitely advise to keep your orchestrators small, and if you find you have a bigger process, then try to chop it up and use the sub orchestrators, like I've showed you. So that's already one step you can do. But again, also keep the number of sub orchestrators also small, because there's nothing that prevents you from nesting a lot of sub orchestrators and go into further sub orchestrators, mm-hmm. even further sub orchestrators. But again, it won't be really visible for the person who will actually read your code, because from the topmost orchestrator, you have no idea what happens more down the line. So I would actually try to prevent the number of sub orchestrators and also the nesting you do. Just keep it at two levels or something, and then. Otherwise, you probably are better off with, again, a separate function app or a separate orchestrator.
There's still no way to make the orchestrations visible with all the activities, right? I think we had a discussion about this several months
indeed.
Ago. I think we posted it on Twitter.
Yeah, indeed.
The function team said they were working on something like this.
They're working on the integration with Application Insights to make it more visible.
The application map or stuff like that.
Yeah, I saw someone else on Twitter asking the same thing again, and again there was a need to reply from the team from, yes, we are aware and we are working on it. So
Azure function teams, if you're watching, we want this.
Yeah, and apparently it's on the radar, but I'm curious when it will be there, because it definitely will be very useful to get some more visibility in there. That's for sure. Yeah. And finally, also try to keep your function app small, because it is. I think sometimes maybe it's too easy to actually put too many responsibilities within one function app. So I've also wrote a blog post about it quite a while ago, but there are some metrics you can use to help you actually limit the number of functions within your function app. So you should really think about more about the domain-driven design and about the context. Does this functionality really belong with the other functionality, or mm-hmm. is it not related at all? So it could be separated out. Also think of scaling requirements. Does all of the functions, do they require the same scaling and the same resources? Because maybe you have some functions there which are really demand really big scaling, but some other functions might not. So that might also be a reason to separate them. There are some guidelines which can help you decide how big should my function app be. I asked it on Twitter a while ago, so how big are your function apps, and are you using durable functions? So I got quite some responses on that, and the majority actually mentioned that we have between 1 and 10 functions in one function app. I think that's a good sign, because it keeps everything small, and that could also be a sign that they're using Azure functions but not really durable functions, because if you're using durable functions, you usually end up with definitely maybe more than 10. For those people it might be definitely worthwhile to have a look into durable functions.
Especially when you make your activities really small. At least that's I think that's the most important, right? Make your activities do one single thing.
Exactly.
No if statement whatsoever in your activity.
No. If statement and business logic should be in the orchestrator, and the activities should just do one thing, because that's also the thing that will the result of it will be persisted and that can be retried. Yeah. So they should be really small.
But then if you have less than 10, then you have like less than 10 if statements in your application, which feels like really small.
That's so, really small. Yeah, indeed. Yeah.
So some of the durable functions I've made were like more like 25 to 30 or that range.
I would still then choose to not have them one orchestrator, but then across sub orchestrators.
Yeah. So maybe they were like five orchestrators.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. So then it's still quite readable and understandable, because I think that's the most important part. From don't let it grow out of hand, so it gets unmanageable. All right. So some more resources. The documentation from Microsoft is, I think, pretty good regarding durable functions. So definitely have a look there. And there are a few more application patterns which I didn't discuss yet, which might be nice to see. So I showed you the C# samples, but there's also a JavaScript samples there. And I think the team is also working on support for PowerShell and also Python, actually, for durable functions. I'm also creating videos about durable functions. I just recently published one around the human interaction part. And finally, if you're totally sick of work and Azure functions, you might want to enjoy a retro game. It's a small puzzle game, 7 levels, so you can keep your mind of something. So that's it.
Yeah. Thanks, Mark. Thanks for this, again, very useful session. Hopefully for the people who never worked with durable functions or Azure functions in general, this is a nice introduction on getting started. I like durable functions myself as well, and I think they have a really good use case. Really simple to create more complex things.
And still easy for developers to understand. They're familiar with the language. And,
very simple to unit test, etc. When you build it the right way.
Exactly.
So hopefully this session will
guide them in the right direction.
Guide our viewers to that direction. So thanks everyone for watching. We haven't announced a next episode, but that will be announced soon. So see you next time. Bye-bye.
Bye.